Hey guys, welcome back to a new video. If you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe so you can catch the new spills every week. And hit that bell up top so you can be part of the notification squad. And that way you won't miss out on quick giveaways like the one in the description. And you get to see all the videos first. Alright, so Batch H is finally here. So now, this character is one of those that really has me thinking. Because you guys that's been rocking with me for a minute, you know I usually stick around in the comments for like the first hour or so. So we can converse about what happened in these spills and also get an idea of your guys' thoughts and reactions. And one of the first things that comes to mind is when we talked about how powerful this character is or potentially can be. And that's even taken us to the place of talking about different characters and comparing them to the Hulk like Adam Brashear. And in that spill, we even broke it down scientifically to who's theoretically stronger. But with the conversations we've had in the comments talking about your Adam Brashear, Blue Marvel, Sentry, Hyperion, and now your Batch H Hulks, both Alpha and Beta, quite often people get to feel like some of these characters are a bit overpowered. And then after that, it kind of stems the argument of where does this character go from here? And that's happened to a lot of highly powered characters' story arcs. Blue Marvel, for example, Superman, for example. But on the contrary, I believe that the problem isn't really the character and what powers they have, but it's more so on the writer. Because Greg Pak, who wrote this series that we're concluding on now, he's also written World War Hulk, he's done work on Adam Warlock, Action Comics, Teen Titans. But Greg Pak is one of those writers who has proven that if you focus on the character and write a good story based around characters, you'll find out that the possibilities are endless. And I feel like he puts that touch on this story arc as well. Alright, so where we left off in a previous video, and I'll leave a link up top for the playlist so anybody who needs to start back over, or if this is the first one you're seeing and you need to start from the top, I got that link ready and waiting for you. But for everybody else, we're just gonna dive right into it. Alright, so in the last video, the team made their way to the Weapon X location in Serenity Hill, Texas. And even though they all went there with the same mission, so to speak, everybody had their own objective, like, individually. Because collectively, the plan was to go there, shut down Weapon X, and stop them from sending out these mutant-killing androids. And everybody was on the same page as far as that. But mainly people like Sabretooth, Logan, and Lady Deathstrike, they're willing to kill whoever they need to just to get it done. And Cho's not cool with that, because one of these subjects, Bobby Andrews in particular, he wants to get him out alive. But his confidence in Logan, Sabretooth, and Lady Deathstrike is kind of wavering because they're killing everybody like all the way there. But remember in the last video, Warpath and Domino have already made their way to Vat H. And at this point, they're down there alone with Batch H Beta. And really all that they're doing at this point is just trying to stay alive till Hulk gets there. And as the story moves forward, we get a better look at Batch H Beta, whose procedure we're going to see even more how it differed from Batch H Alpha. Because she goes on to explain it, aside from what's visually obvious. And while Cho's fighting Beta, he's constantly trying to get Bobby to snap out of it, so to speak. But Dr. Alba goes on to explain that his procedure included removing large parts of his brain that only left like the animal instinct and the anger, in order to just make him strictly a killing machine. But Cho continues to really try to tap in and help him out. But since Cho and H Beta's fight is like tearing apart the building, that leaves Warpath and Domino to try to save the other people so they don't become casualties. Because aside from it being a Weapon X facility, it's in a location to where if that building goes down, a lot of innocent people around are going to be killed. And this takes me back to something we talked about a little bit in previous videos. And I mean that in references to times where Cho has had appearances of seeming like the old Hulk or the Bruce Banner Hulk. But there's been a couple of small occasions where we kind of get this glimpse or this idea that the Hulk within Bruce Banner still lives deep, deep down subconsciously within Amadeus Cho. And we've had these glimpses before into his subconscious that kind of supported the theory, but it's never really been confirmed 100%. It's kind of just been delivered to us in this way of, hey, okay, well, let's just play with this idea. But in this issue here where Dr. Alba's like, let him out, let him loose, stop holding back, let us see what he's really capable of, it feels a lot like she understands or she's aware of this duality to an extent. And I'll probably do a separate video just talking about the whole idea of this Hulk within that was passed from Banner to Cho. And that is not just this brute strength and green skin. Because theoretically, if he absorbed the Hulk in its entirety from Banner, then that means that he's carrying a whole lot of subconscious identities and abilities along with it. And that in turn makes it possible for Cho to reach strength levels that Bruce Banner has as well too. Like your Heart of the Monster, your World War Hulk, or your World Breaker Hulk. And it's possible that Cho may even use the same device that he uses to turn into the Hulk to switch between different Hulk personas. But all this is really right here is just him scaling back a bit and letting the Hulk take the wheel for a minute. Because he's come to the realization that Bobby Andrews is virtually already dead, like his brother who suffered a similar fate. So for that reason, he's got to destroy this weapon. There's no soul inside of there anymore. And as a quick reminder, Batch H Beta is more so the soldier that Reverend Stryker wanted. And that's why he went through the whole handpick process for the candidate for that program. I mean, he wanted whoever he chose, he wanted their hatred to run down through their blood, through their DNA. But H. Alpha, on the other hand, Dr. Alba kept completely secret. And with her working for Stryker, it's almost like her character is like, okay, Stryker, I hear what you're saying. I'm going to do what you're asking, but I'm also going to get it done the right way. And that's also why with H. Alpha, she left him more of his brain and more of his memories, because she strongly emphasized how disciplined this candidate was. And that ties a lot into her decision for not replacing a lot of his body with mechanics, but leaving a majority of him organic. Because in contrary to what Stryker thought would work, Dr. Alba noticed that a lot of these highly unstable candidates would either physically fall apart or need a majority of their body to be made of mechanical prosthetics to sustain body mass. I mean, which kind of defeats the purpose of making a Hulk. Because what's a Hulk without body mass? Right. And Dr. Alba knew in a lot of previous cases that those candidates would fail. Like, she would call it before it happened. But a lot of those experiments she would go ahead and do just kind of as a cover-up. And the other high-risk experiments she was using more so as research, so she wouldn't have to take that kind of risk with Alpha. But that stuff you'll kind of put together reading throughout this series. But when Dr. Alba sends H-Alpha after Amadeus, like, Cho is still outside fighting the first one. And then he sees Alpha show up and he's like, damn, another one? But this right here is when one of my previous theories actually gets confirmed. Because when Beta stabs Hulk from behind, Alpha comes up and decapitates him. And there's not a whole lot that we know about this character. We just kind of got to go off his actions and the things that Dr. Alba says about him, like his personality being more like Wolverine. And I believe that's one of the biggest clues that we have to his identity before it's truly revealed. Because if you never read a comic book about Wolverine, if this was your first time seeing him ever, what would be your call in this character? Would he be a hero? Would he be a villain? I'll even go as far to say, in the same circumstance where you've never heard of him before, what if somebody just handed you a folder and it contained information saying what his abilities were, how he was created, and perhaps a couple examples of things that he's done? It's highly likely that you probably just chalk this guy up as a villain. And I believe that's the case with H. Alpha. We can only guess at this point because we really don't know the guy. But a person's actions speak a lot for their character. And for right now, that's all we really have to go off of for H. Alpha. And so when his memory starts coming back to him and he goes to attack the Weapon X security, it's hard to say whether he was trying to get at Dr. Alba or if he just wanted revenge with Weapon X for what they did to him. It's tough to say at this point, but when Cho stops him from tearing him to pieces, you immediately see his attention shift from Dr. Alba over to Amadeus Cho. And right there, man, it turns into the stare down. Cho on one side, he's ready to get it popping, but H. Alpha doesn't even engage. He puts his claws away. And that was probably a good thing for Cho, because you've seen what he did with Beta. But this takes me back to what I mentioned earlier about us finding out what type of person H. Alpha is before we really find out who he is. Because he could have just broke out, went on a killing spree, and there's not much a lot of people could have done about it. And that definitely would have been a level 8 threat. By the way, let me know in the comments if you know what I'm talking about right there. But with him deciding to leave and not just murder Cho right here in front of everybody, that says a lot to the potential of who this character is. And it doesn't help, like, in the least bit that Sabretooth has jokes about it, like, right after. First of all, dude, too soon. Second of all, like, do you really want to go there again? But that'll do it for this one, guys. Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Me, personally, I can't wait to learn more about this character. Where has he come from? Have we met him before? Who does he stand with? Who does he stand against? See, I'm real character-driven. Whether it's comics, whether it's movies, especially if it's games. But those are just some of the things that I can't wait to see. But let me know you guys' thoughts below. Giveaway details are in the description. That ends in less than a week. Don't forget to smash that like button for your boy. And I also want to give a shout out to our newest Patreon, William Birch, and really all the patrons for that matter, because you guys are what's really making it possible for me to do more videos and do more contests and giveaways as well. And I don't take that lightly. I love doing these spills, and I hope to do many more as we expand and grow. But that's it, you guys. I got links up so you can check out other videos. I got a playlist here if you want to start back at the top for Weapons of Mutant Destruction. Other videos with more claw action for my Wolverine fans who can't get enough. And I also talk TV, movies, and have another gaming channel as well. And those links are always up top or down in the description for you guys to check out. But y'all take it easy, and I will catch you guys on the next one. All right, later.